Hi there, I am Coach Carl, and the Boston Marathon is coming up quickly. So I wanted to talk in this video about how I think is an appropriate way to pace Boston, as well as some suggestions about how you can approach the race and the race plan to make sure that you have a successful race. Now I want to start with what I would consider a marathon racing truth, and this is that running close to even or running negative splits is going to be the best approach. Now, negative splits, in my mind, they make sense physiologically, right? They sort of work through our energy systems in the correct order. It's good not to go into oxygen debt and have to slow down later in the race. It's good to stay on the correct side, the aerobic side of that lactate threshold early in the race so that you have more energy to push later in the race. And I think it's easier psychologically to run negative splits as well. I think it's much easier to feel good and to be passing people late in a marathon than to be trying to talk yourself into, this is fine that I'm slowing down, this is fine, everything's fine. And I think also it's very important to note that negative splits work in real life. So if you look at the winners from the World Marathon Majors of this past round of World Marathon Majors, 2022, 2023, we look at the men's winners, we look at the women's winners, you'll see 50-50, whether it's a negative split or whether it's a positive split, although most of the positive splits, except for Chicago women's winner, very close to even as well. So if we talk about even splits being a range from 2% slower to 2% faster, I think that gives us a good range to work with that can really help guide your racing in real world scenarios. And I think you'll see this same range of 2% slower to 2% faster with marathon major winners. I think you'll see it with world record holders, and I think you'll see it with the PRs of elite runners as well. It's a good range to shoot for. So how fast should your first half be in that case? Well, this chart here will show you different goal race times and what your first half would be to be 2% faster than goal pace, as well as 2% slower than goal pace. And you'll see it's a pretty generous range. If you're someone who likes to go out fast, who gains some confidence by going out fast, you've got some time to work with there. If you're somebody who prefers to be more relaxed at the start, or if you're worried about being in a situation where your corral is going to be crowded and you may not be able to run the pace that you want to early on, I think this just goes to show that you don't have to fight your way through the crowds. You can take your time, relax, find your spots to pick it up, and still be in a good place to run well. And I think also it's important to note here that if you just mess up your pacing a little bit, that you've got some wiggle room here too. You know, if you're running for 3 hours and you want to run it right at 1:30, well, if you're a little fast, you're a little slow, I think you're still in a good position to run the time that you want to run. So that's all well and good, but let's talk about Boston. All right, I still think that negative and even splits are the best approach. And I know that that may sound a little confusing because you've got so much downhill early on in the race and so much uphill later in the race, but I think you want to consider the idea of banking energy in the first half of the race rather than banking time. I think the same percentages are going to apply, but I think you can stretch it out just a little bit. I think 3% faster in the first half is okay in Boston, given the course profile. I don't think that you want to go any faster than that, or you risk getting out of those energy systems that you want to be using the first half of a marathon, getting into oxygen debt, and then trying to fight through that and work your way back while you're also running uphill. So when I was preparing this talk, I went back through and looked at people that I've coached in the last few years that have PR'd at Boston, and their splits ranged from -3.1% to 8% positive split. And that 8% was definitely the outlier. I think it's important to note that was only her second marathon ever. And so she probably had a little more wiggle room to run an 8% positive split and still PR. So take that into account. Now, as far as how to actually approach the race itself in Boston, I think you can split Boston into four acts. Act one, the downhill start. Okay, this is miles 1 through 8, and you're gonna be fighting the downhill course a little bit. You've got the energy of the crowd getting you all excited, and you've got all the excitement waiting around all morning as well. So if you're gonna try to run even, if you're gonna try to run negative, you're gonna have to work these first 8 miles not to get carried away, because you have a lot of things working against you where you're, you know, going to be tempted to run faster than you should. So it's very important here to stick to your plan and to hold back in that first act. Act 2 is what I would call the long cruise, so this is miles 8 through 16. The big downhill's finished, you're not to the hills yet, and you can just relax and cover ground in this section, and you can maintain your pace. Okay, so this isn't an area where I think you want to think about trying to make up time, right? If we're talking about 2% or 3% faster, realistically, most of that's probably gonna happen in those first 8 miles. I wouldn't try to make up any of that time here. I think that needs to have already happened. And as a side note, I think this is the point in the race where you really wanna make sure that your fueling plan is on point. And the reason I say that is because those first 8 miles, it can be easy to kind of lose track of the fueling plan. And after mile 16, it's probably too late to get back on track with your fueling plan. So making sure that you've got that really nailed down in miles 8 through 16 will also help you run a stronger second half of the race. Act 3, Newton Hills. This is miles 16 through 21. And here you want to focus more on effort than on pace, right? You probably will slow down a little bit from what you were running miles 8 through 16. Hopefully nothing significant, but that's why you want to focus on effort. If you try to maintain your pace, you probably will be running too hard right now, which means you won't be able to take advantage of the final miles of the race. And so if you focus on effort, you slow down a little bit, then you will be able to crest those hills and get after it in the final miles. Now, I think it's important to note that mile 19 is a trap. You do not want to push the downhill there. You do not want to get carried away on the downhill because heartbreak is next. And any hill with a name, you've got to respect, especially when the name is heartbreak. All right, act number 4, the downhill finish. This is miles 21 through the end, and your legs will be tired at this point after coming through the uphill. So that's why it's so important that I think that your energy systems are not overly tired as well. That's why it's important to focus on the effort. If you get to the top, your legs are tired, but your body overall feels good, you can sort of let loose on the downhills, use that to your advantage, and push these final miles. If your legs are tired and your body's tired, then you're gonna go slow. Your brain will be tired as well. And so I think it's important to use those mantras and that self-talk that hopefully you're practicing in your long runs to carry you through these miles. And I think you wanna focus on the moment, focus on the crowd energy, you know, let that push you through these final miles and use the energy that you banked earlier in the race. Maybe you won't have a blazing last few miles, but you should not be falling behind on pace in these miles. Now, a couple things to include in your training to help you accomplish this. The start time of Boston is a little problematic. So you wanna have at least one long run where you practice the 10 a.m. start time and you practice what you're gonna eat for breakfast, how you're gonna fuel, all those sorts of things so that you are ready and your body knows what to expect in that situation. I think you also, in these final weeks, want to practice goal pace on downhills. If you've only been doing goal pace practice so far on flat stretches or maybe even on uphill stretches to prepare for the hills, make sure you practice it on downhills as well, because you want to know what that effort feels like on a long, sustained downhill, because otherwise, highly likely that you will run too fast in those first 8 miles. And so I think you can do this as part of a long run. I think you can do it as part of a workout, but making sure that it's a long stretch, as long as you can find, it doesn't need to be a super steep downhill, but making sure that you practice that goal pace in that setting will go a long way towards making sure that those first 8 miles are productive. So to wrap up and to recap just a few general thoughts on negative and even splits, this is a learned skill. And so I think that you wanna make it a habit in your long runs and in your daily runs, and you wanna practice it and practice it in your workouts. And the more that your brain and your body get used to the idea of running hard when you're tired, the easier negative splits are going to be in the race. And I think you wanna make sure during the race itself that you think big picture about the negative split and not mile by mile. There will always be fluctuations in individual miles, whether that's because of aid stations or because of crowds or because of, you know, saying hi to friends as you run by them. So focusing on the big picture, knowing some checkpoints along the way and what range of times you want to be at those checkpoints, and making sure that it is a range, I think will go a long way towards helping you structure it and set you up for success. Finally, I think you want to think about banking energy and not banking time, because if you get carried away early on in Boston, no amount of time that you bank is going to make up for it if you're just crawling up those hills. But if you have the energy to really maintain and maybe even push miles 16 through 21, you're gonna run great. So those are my thoughts on how to approach Boston as far as pacing, as far as strategy. I'd love to hear your thoughts and suggestions in the comment section below, and I hope that you have a great rest of your day.